Hello, everybody. I'm Barry Tompkins, and welcome to Great Moments in College Bowl History. You know, as we approach the new year, it is the season for college football to take center stage, as schools from across the country prepare to go bowling. Whether it's the Rose, Sugar, Cotton, or Orange, each bowl has its own personality, distinct pageantry, and most notably, exciting football between the very best teams in the country. Today, we'll go back in time to feature some of the more memorable moments in bowl history. You'll see Wrong Way Roy Regals in the Rose Bowl, Joe Montana's miracle comeback in the Cotton Bowl, Alabama's dramatic goal line stand in the Sugar Bowl, and we'll relive the explosive 1984 Orange Bowl between Nebraska and Miami. Plus, you'll see highlights from other exciting bowls like the Fiesta, Gator, Bluebonnet, and Holiday Bowl. We'll also pay tribute to some not-so-memorable bowl classics, like the Rumba, Salad, and Oil Bowls. You remember those, don't you? All that and much, much more as 44 Blue Sports presents Great Moments in College Bowl History. You know, the oldest and most traditional bowl in college football history is the Rose Bowl. The first game, played back in 1902, was a complete mismatch as Michigan's point-a-minute Wolverines destroyed Stanford 49-0. The results were so devastating that the California Festival organizers dropped the football competition in favor of, get this, chariot races. Football was finally reinstated in 1916, and this time the West Coast team won as Washington State defeated Brown 14-0. Since then, Pasadena has been the place to be on New Year's Day, and here's a look back at the granddaddy of them all. In 1925, Notre Dame, with Coach Newt Rockne and the Four Horsemen, whipped Pop Warner's Stanford team, led by fullback Ernie Nevers, 27-10. Said Rockne after the game, "The Four Horsemen have the right to ride with the gridiron greats." The 1929 Rose Bowl featured one of the most infamous plays in college football history. California lineman Roy Regals picked up a Georgia Tech fumble and raced 80 yards towards the goal line. Unfortunately, it was his own goal line. Teammate Benny Lahm finally brought him down at the one. On the ensuing play, California tried to punt out of danger, but the kick was blocked out of the end zone. The two-point safety proved to be the final margin of victory as Georgia Tech edged California 8-7. The 1935 Rose Bowl featured the H Boys of Alabama, halfback Dixie Howell and N. Don Hudson. They led the Crimson Tide to a 29-13 victory over Stanford. The two combined for 256 yards and 22 points in the second quarter alone. Howell also completed three passes that day to a skinny end named Paul Bryant. The 1941 Rose Bowl ushered in the modern era of the T formation as Stanford, led by quarterback Frankie Albert, defeated Nebraska 21-13. The 1947 Classic witnessed the inauguration of the present-day Big Ten versus Pac-10 series. On this day, the Fighting Illini walloped UCLA 45-14. The only highlight for Bruin fans was a Rose Bowl record 103-yard kickoff return for a touchdown by Al Hoisch. Number 2 Michigan State and number 4 UCLA battled right down to the wire in the 1956 Rose Bowl. With time running out, Spartan coach Duffy Daugherty pulled his regular place kicker, who had already missed three attempts that day, for N. Dave Kaiser. Kaiser, who was playing without his contact lens, had to look at the referee to see whether he'd made the kick. Amazingly, the ball traveled 41 yards straight through the uprights for a dramatic last-second 17-14 Michigan State win. One of the greatest passing displays in bowl history occurred in the 1963 Rose Bowl between number 1 ranked USC and number 2 ranked Wisconsin. Led by All-American quarterback Pete Beathard, who set a Rose Bowl record with 4 touchdown passes, USC played like national champions, cruising to a 42-14 lead going to the final period. Many of the 100,000 fans had left the scene when Wisconsin suddenly erupted. Badger quarterback Ron Vanderkellen went wild, rallying his team to 23 straight points. He would go on to complete 33 of 48 passes, a record 401 yards. With a little over a minute to play and trailing 42-37, Wisconsin's onside kick failed as USC narrowly escaped one of the greatest rallies in college football history. The 1969 Rose Bowl was billed as the dream game of the year. Number one ranked Ohio State with coach Woody Hayes versus number two ranked USC and their head coach John McKay. The powerful Trojans jumped out to a 10-0 lead behind this electrifying 80-yard touchdown run by Heisman Trophy winner O.J. Simpson.
He's on his feet and running down across the 50. He's to the 40. He's to the 30. Nobody's going to catch him. He has blockers alongside. He walks into the end zone.
However, the Buckeyes battled back, taking advantage of numerous USC turnovers. Quarterback Rex Kern threw for two touchdowns as Ohio State captured a 27-16 victory, earning Woody Hayes his third Rose Bowl crown. In the early 1970s, the Stanford Indians put together two stunning upsets over Big Ten powers. Ohio State was a heavy favorite to win the 1971 Rose Bowl behind the hard running of fullback John Brockington. However, Stanford rallied behind Heisman Trophy quarterback Jim Plunkett to pull off one of the biggest upsets in Rose Bowl history.
Plunkett back to pass. He's looking across the middle. There he's got a man. Baton, the end zone. Touchdown, Stanford Indians.
Final score, Stanford 27, Ohio State 17. The following year, Stanford pulled off another upset, shocking undefeated Michigan on a last-second field goal to win 13-12. The 1973 Rose Bowl can be summed up in these words, Sam Bam Cunningham. This USC fullback turned out Ohio State's lights in the second half by powering for four touchdowns to lead the Trojans to a 42-17 rout. USC finished the season 12-0 to capture the national title. The same two teams met in 1980, but this time the game was close. Down by six with just over 5 minutes to play, USC kept the ball on the ground. On that final drive, the game plan was simple. It was student body right and student body left, as Heisman Trophy tailback Charles White carried six times for 71 yards, including the game-winning dive from 1 yard out.
The ball right up against the Ohio State goal line. The quarterback is McDonald. The give. White's in the air. He's in the end zone. The Trojans have scored.
USC pulled out a thrilling 17-16 victory over the Buckeyes. The 1980s witnessed two exceptional Rose Bowl performances by freshmen. In 1982, Washington tailback Jacques Robinson became the first freshman ever to win Player of the Game honors as he rushed for over 140 yards and scored two touchdowns, leading the Huskies over Iowa 28-0. 4 years later, in 1986, it was UCLA tailback Eric Ball who became the freshman sensation. When the dust settled, his numbers were staggering. He carried 22 times, 227 yards, and four touchdowns, leading UCLA past the Iowa Hawkeyes by a score of 45-28. Each New Year's Day in Dallas, Texas, you'll find the bands, the fans, and all the spirit associated with college football. Since 1942, the Southwest Conference has sent its champion to the Mobile Cotton Bowl Classic to battle the top teams in the country. For over five decades, the bowl has been a showcase for some outstanding individual performances. On January 1st, 1946, Texas quarterback Bobby Lane turned in one of the greatest games in bowl history. Lane was responsible for all the Longhorns' points on that day as Texas defeated Missouri 40-27. He threw for two touchdowns, ran for three scores, kicked four extra points, and was on the receiving end of a 50-yard scoring strike. After the game, Tiger coach Chauncey Simpson walked over to shake Lane's hand and said, "Never saw a better job by anybody." Was a day legendary Texas quarterback Bobby Lane would never forget. The 1949 Cotton Bowl featured what many people called the dream backfield. SMU's Heisman Trophy winner Doak Walker and super sophomore Kyle Roach versus the best team from the West, Oregon, and their great passer, Norm Van Brocklin. The Mustangs, who had lost only once in the past 2 years, were making their second straight Cotton Bowl appearance as a packed crowd of 70,000 showed up to see the fireworks. SMU used a bit of razzle-dazzle to take an early lead as Walker and Rote led the Mustang charge. However, the Ducks stayed close with this 24-yard touchdown pass from Van Brocklin to Dick Wilkins. But SMU had just too many weapons as Kyle Rote broke free on this great 36-yard run to preserve a 21-13 Mustang victory. One of the most bizarre and talked-about plays in Cotton Bowl history occurred in the 1954 Classic. Rice halfback Dickie Maegle was streaking down the sidelines when suddenly Alabama's Tommy Lewis blindsided him from out of bounds. Maegle lay motionless on the field as some 75,000 fans looked on in disbelief. While Lewis buried his head on the sidelines, referee Cliff Shaw hesitated briefly before awarding Maegle a touchdown. The celebrated bench tackle overshadowed an awesome performance by Maegle, who set a record by rushing for 265 yards, scoring 3 touchdowns, and leading Rice to a 28-6 win over Bama. The Cotton Bowl ushered in 1957 with a classic matchup. From the East, eighth-ranked and once-beaten Syracuse was led by All-America halfback Jim Brown. From the South, it was a tough Texas Christian squad making their second straight appearance in Dallas. This game lived up to all its hype as a wild offensive show. TCU jumped on top early 14-0, but the Orange men countered with rugged Jim Brown, who was virtually a one-man show, rushing for 132 yards and scoring 3 touchdowns. He also kicked 3 extra points, but it wasn't enough. The difference in the game in the fourth quarter when TCU's Chico Mendoza crashed through to block a Brown extra point as the Frogs held on for a thrilling 28-27 win. The 1964 Classic featured Navy's Heisman Trophy winner Roger Staubach. The Eastern Press had proclaimed for weeks that Navy, not Texas, was the nation's best team. However, the Longhorns and their coach Darryl Royal were determined to remain number one in the rankings. Texas took little time in proving their point. This 63-yard touchdown pass from quarterback Duke Carlisle to end Phil Harris broke the game wide open as the Longhorns exploded to a 28-0 lead. The Texas defense was spectacular, keeping Roger the Dodger in check all day and limiting Navy to minus 14 yards rushing. The talented Staubach had finished the game throwing for 227 yards, but Texas proved just too much for the middies as the Longhorns capped an undefeated season by winning convincingly 28-6. On January 1st, 1970, the nation's eyes would focus upon Dallas and a dream Cotton Bowl matchup, number one-ranked Texas versus Notre Dame, the legendary gridiron powerhouse, making its first postseason appearance in 45 years. Coach Ara Parsegian and the Irish had plenty of incentive in upsetting the Longhorns. And when the Irish jumped out to a 10-0 lead on this bomb from quarterback Joe Theismann to Tom Gatewood, the game looked to have the makings of a colossal upset.
To the 10, to the 5, into the end zone. Touchdown, Irish!
Texas fought back behind star quarterback James Street and a tough ground game that featured Steve Worcester, Jim Bertelsen, and Ted Coy as the Longhorns regained the lead 14-10. Now it was Notre Dame's turn to move. Theismann directed an 80-yard drive that ended with this 24-yard scoring pass to halfback Jim Yoder. Notre Dame 17, Texas 14, with time running out. The Longhorns had one last chance. Fourth down at the Irish 10 with just over a minute to play. Street's pass was short, but Cotton Spire made a diving catch for the first down. Texas punched it in from the 1 and pulled out a dramatic 21-17 win for its second national championship. The temperature at kickoff for the 1979 Classic was 20 degrees with a wind chill factor of -6. It was possibly the worst conditions ever for a major bowl. But even the elements could not dampen the spirit of this Cotton Bowl matchup between the Houston Cougars and their exciting Veer offense and the Notre Dame Fighting Irish with their unflappable quarterback, Joe Montana. Coach Dan Devine's Irish jumped out to a 12-0 lead, taking advantage of a pair of Cougar fumbles. Just when it looked like Notre Dame could phone the score in, the momentum shifted, and shifted quickly. Houston ran off 34 straight points, and with 7 minutes 37 seconds left in the game, the score was Cougars 34, Irish 12. Newt Rockne must have been looking down upon the Cotton Bowl this icy day, as the Irish staged one of the greatest comebacks in bowl history. First, they blocked a punt and returned it 33 yards for a touchdown. A two-point conversion made it 34-20. Then Joe Montana directed a 61-yard drive for a touchdown and another two-point conversion. With 4:15 left in the game, Notre Dame had closed the gap to 34-28. With 1:50 to play, Houston gambled on a 4th-and-1 at its own 29-yard line. They never made it. Notre Dame now had the ball with one last chance.
Throws for the end zone, diving catch by Chris Haynes. Is he inbound? Yes!
Joe Unis kicked the game-winning extra point as the Fighting Irish pulled off a miracle. 35-34, the final. It took the dreams and efforts of a New Orleans sports columnist by the name of Fred Digby for the Sugar Bowl Football Classic to become a reality. The first game was played in Tulane Stadium. If you wondered about the name of the Sugar Bowl, it was the site of a former sugar plantation. Simple, don't you think? A crowd of over 22,000 showed up on January 1st, 1935, as the Green Wave of Tulane upset Temple and its legendary coach Pop Warner 20-14. Since then, the game has moved into the Louisiana Superdome as the USF&G Sugar Bowl and has consistently attracted the nation's top teams. The 1947 Sugar Bowl was billed as the Battle of the Halfbacks, the Georgia Bulldogs' Charlie Trippi versus North Carolina and its star runner, Charlie Choo Choo Justice. Undefeated Georgia had to rally twice to stave off an upset bid by the Tar Heels, as this pass from Trippi to Dan Edwards iced the game.
He's at the 30, the 20, the 10, the 5, and he's over! Edwards scores for Georgia on a 67-yard run.
Both heralded backs played superb football. However, it was Charlie Trippi and the Georgia Bulldogs prevailing in the end, 20-10. The 1951 Sugar Bowl featured a star-studded cast. Coach Bear Bryant's Kentucky Wildcats could boast quarterback Babe Parilli and All-American tackle Bob Gain. Bud Wilkinson's Sooners favored halfback Billy Vessels. More importantly, Oklahoma had run their amazing winning streak to 31 straight games, the longest in college football history. On this day, though, the Kentucky defense was awesome, forcing an uncharacteristic 7 Sooner fumbles. Meanwhile, Parilli's touchdown pass to halfback Shorty Jamerson proved to be the difference as Bear Bryant's Wildcats stunned the Sooners 13-7. Said Coach Wilkinson after the game, "I can state sincerely that we lost to a great team, a great school, and a great state." Neither Missouri nor Florida were ranked in the top 5 when they hooked up in the 1966 Sugar Bowl. However, the two teams put on the best display of football in any of the major bowls on that day. Down 20-0 in the 4th quarter, Florida quarterback Steve Spurrier went to work. This 22-yard pass made the score 20-6. Next, Spurrier's 2-yard quarterback sneak cut the lead to 20-12.
I'm running out on the Gators. They're at the 21-yard line. Spurrier back to throw again. Looks downfield. Goes to his left. Has a receiver. Ball is deflected. Casey caught it anyhow. What a catch. It's 20-18. What a comeback by the Gators.
Although the Gators' two-point conversion failed, Spurrier's 18 points in 9 minutes accounted for one of the great rallies in bowl history. The 1977 Sugar Bowl was supposed to be a close, hard-fought battle between the Pitt Panthers and the Georgia Bulldogs. It never was. Behind the passing of quarterback Matt Kavanaugh and the running of Tony Dorsett, who finished the game by rushing for a Sugar Bowl record 202 yards, Pittsburgh overwhelmed Georgia 27-3 to win the national championship. Penn State, under Joe Paterno, brought their 19-game winning streak and number one ranking to the 1979 Sugar Bowl, but Bear Bryant's second-ranked Alabama team was hungry for a win that would give them a national title. It was only the fifth major bowl matchup in history between the nation's top-ranked teams. The Crimson Tide struck first as quarterback Jeff Rutledge connected with Bruce Bolton just 8 seconds left in the half for a 7-0 lead. Penn State tied the game in the third quarter on this 17-yard pass from Chuck Fusina to Scott Fitzke. Alabama regained the lead on Major Ogilvie's 7-yard carry to go in front 14-7. However, Penn State had one last chance as they recovered a Crimson Tide fumble deep in Alabama territory. On a second and goal, Scott Fitzke was stopped short of the goal line with a great tackle by Don McNeil. Third and goal from the one, fullback Matsui was blasted for no gain. It was now fourth and goal for the national championship.
Fourth and goal at the one of the national championship comes down to one play. Chuck Fusina at quarterback. Hands off to Gooman. Dive to the goal line. Doesn't get in. Alabama's Barry Krause has stopped him. What a play and what a goal line.
Alabama's dramatic goal line stand preserved a 14-7 victory and earned them the national championship. Over 77,000 fans packed the Superdome in 1981 to see the Fighting Irish attempt to stop Georgia's freshman sensation, Herschel Walker. Though Notre Dame turned in a spirited defensive effort, Walker proved to be too much to handle. Herschel finished with 150 yards rushing and scored two touchdowns to lead Georgia to their first national championship, 17-10. Herschel and the Bulldogs returned to New Orleans the following year to take on Dan Marino and the Pitt Panthers. In this game, the lead changed hands five times. Walker scored twice on runs of 8 and 10 yards. However, Marino completed 26 of 41 passes for 261 yards and 3 touchdowns as the Panthers upset Georgia 24-20. The 1983 Sugar Bowl was once again the site where the nation's top two ranked teams met to decide the championship. Georgia and Heisman Trophy winner Herschel Walker were ranked number one. Their opponent, Joe Paterno's Nittany Lions, were led by quarterback Todd Blackledge. Penn State jumped off to a 20-3 lead behind the exciting running of Kurt Warner. The Dogs fought back to cut the lead to 20-17. However, when everything seemed to be falling apart, Joe Paterno sent in a little surprise from the sideline. First, a play-action fake to Warner. Then, Blackledge dropped back in the pocket and heaved a 47-yard pass into the end zone, where it was caught by a diving Greg Garrity. This great catch proved to be the winning score as the Nittany Lions defeated Georgia 27-23, giving Joe Paterno and Penn State their long-sought national championship.
If sunny California could have a New Year's Day football spectacle, by gosh, why couldn't sunny Southern Florida? So speculated a group of businessmen back in the early 1930s. They had no trouble selling the idea in tourist-happy Miami. The first official Orange Bowl was played in 1935 on the site of what is today the Orange Bowl Stadium. On that day, 5,000 spectators witnessed Bucknell thrash the Miami Hurricanes 26-0. And so the Federal Express Orange Bowl, as it's known now, established itself as a major contender for national attention.
The eyes of Texas were upon the 1949 Orange Bowl as quarterback Tom Landry led the Longhorns to 343 yards rushing and a 41-28 upset victory over the heavily favored Georgia Bulldogs. The 69-point total still stands as a record Orange Bowl high. Bud Wilkinson Sooners had treated Oklahoma fans to 29 consecutive victories by the time they arrived at the Orange Bowl on the first day of 1956. Their opponent was an undefeated Maryland club coached by Jim Tatum. The Terrapins played a determined first half, and behind triple threat terror Ed Verup, they went into the locker room leading 6-0. The Sooners came out fired up in the second half as All-American Tommy McDonald raced around end to give Oklahoma the lead. The Sooners clinched the game in the fourth quarter when Carl Dodd snatched a Maryland pass and raced 82 yards for the game's final score. Oklahoma extended its winning streak to 30 games with a 20-6 victory. With President John F. Kennedy looking on, Coach Bud Wilkinson and Bear Bryant squared off in the 1963 Orange Bowl. Alabama wasted little time as a young sophomore quarterback named Joe Willie Namath put the Crimson Tide on top 7-0. However, the key to the game was the defensive play of Alabama captain Leroy Jordan, who recorded an incredible 31 tackles. Jordan almost single-handedly thwarted the high-powered Sooner offense, holding Oklahoma to only 52 yards rushing. In the end, Bear Bryant's Crimson Tide had posted an impressive 17-0 shutout. The 1965 Orange Bowl featured Texas versus Alabama, with retired coach Bud Wilkinson now in the broadcast booth. The nation's spotlight shined on young Texas coach Darryl Royal and on Alabama's legendary coach, Bear Bryant. All-American quarterback Joe Namath led the undefeated and number one ranked Crimson Tide against the underdog Longhorns in what was to be the first ever Orange Bowl night game. Texas broke out on top early with this 79-yard run by halfback Ernie Coy. Next, the Longhorns went to the air as quarterback Jim Judson hit streaking split end George Sauer on a 69-yard touchdown pass. Texas led 21-7 before Namath rallied the tide with this 20-yard completion to Ray Perkins. Alabama had a chance to win late in the game as Namath directed the tide down to the Longhorn goal line.
Namath at quarterback, fourth and goal at the Texas one-yard line. Namath over the ball. He tries to sneak in. He does not get there. Tommy Novus stops him, and Texas hangs on to win the Orange Bowl.
A tired Joe Namath tried to sneak it in, but Texas courageously held to escape with a 21-17 upset victory. There was no national championship on the line when Tennessee and Oklahoma hooked up in the 1968 Orange Bowl. However, these two teams played one of the most exciting games in bowl history. The Sooners, behind the rugged running of Steve Owens, built a 19-0 lead at halftime and seemed to have the game in hand. Suddenly, in the third quarter, the Volunteers came to life with this 36-yard interception returned for a touchdown. Oklahoma led 26-24 with less than a minute remaining when they decided to go for a fourth and one at their own 43. The gamble didn't pay off as the Vols turned back Steve Owens to take over with 14 seconds to play. Carl Kressmer lined up for a 43-yard kick to win the game.
33 kneeling down, 26-24. Awaiting the snap from center, here it is, the boot, it's up. What about it? Is it?
His attempt was wide. The Oklahoma fans erupted as the Sooners dodged the bullet, winning 26-24. In the 1970s, the University of Oklahoma posted some big Orange Bowl victories. In 76, the Sooners survived a defensive battle against Big Ten power Michigan with a tough 14-6 win, thus claiming the national championship. 3 years later, Superback Billy Sims led Oklahoma to a revenge victory over Nebraska, 31-24, in the first ever matchup of two Big Eight teams in a bowl game. The following year, the Sooners and their coach Barry Switzer faced Bobby Bowden's Florida State Seminoles. It was no contest. Oklahoma rushed for 411 yards and cruised to a 24-7 win. In what arguably could be the greatest college bowl game ever played, the number one ranked Nebraska Cornhuskers faced the talented Miami Hurricanes in the 1984 Orange Bowl. The winner of this game would be the national champion. The Hurricanes lived up to their nickname in the first quarter as quarterback Bernie Kosar and company blew past the stunned Cornhuskers for a 17-0 lead. In the second quarter, it was Nebraska's turn. As coach Tom Osborne dipped into his bag of tricks, he called for an intentional fumble, the fumble rooski, and guard Dean Steinkuhler rambled 19 yards for a touchdown, pulling the Cornhuskers to within three at halftime. The Hurricanes came out firing in the third quarter behind Kosar's pinpoint passing and Alonzo Highsmith's running to take another big lead at 31-17. But once again, Nebraska fought back. With less than 2 minutes to play and down by 6 points, Turner Gill connected with dangerous Irving Fryer as the Cornhuskers moved into Miami territory. Then, with 48 seconds to play and faced with a fourth and eight, Nebraska back Jeff Smith took a pitch and went all the way for the touchdown to cut Miami's lead to one. Coach Osborne immediately decided to go for the two-point conversion and the win.
Miami and Nebraska for the national championship. It comes down to a two-point try for the extra point. Turner Gill rolling to his right for Nebraska. Throws, knocked down! Miami Hurricanes have knocked the ball down. They will win and hang on for the national championship.
Miami had won the national championship in a game that will long be remembered as one of college football's finest.
As you've seen so far, the major bowl games, the Rose Bowl, the Cotton Bowl, the Sugar Bowl, and the Orange Bowl, have always garnered most media attention. However, every holiday season, there are numerous bowls across the country which have offered college football fans their share of great plays, dramatic finishes, and memorable moments. Let's take a look.
The Sunkissed Fiesta Bowl started out in the early 1970s in Tempe, Arizona. Talk about a home field advantage. The Arizona State Sun Devils won four of the first five games played in its backyard. It was not until 1987 that the Fiesta Bowl made headlines across the country by staging a national championship game between Penn State and Miami. The Lions defeated the Hurricanes and quarterback Vinny Testaverde that evening 14-10 to win the national title. Jacksonville, Florida was the site of the first Gator Bowl in 1946. Over the years, the Mazda Gator Bowl has showcased many stars. In 1966, Syracuse featured the power of hard-nosed fullback Larry Zonka and the speed of number 44, Floyd Little. Even with all that talent, the Orange Men lost to Tennessee on that day, 18-12. In 1971, two famous quarterbacks squared off. Auburn's Heisman Trophy winner Pat Sullivan versus Mississippi's Archie Manning. Playing with a cast on his left arm, Manning courageously tried to rally Ole Miss late in the game with this exciting run. However, Auburn held on to win a thriller, 35-28. One of the greatest single plays in bowl history occurred at the 1962 Liberty Bowl Classic, when Oregon State's Heisman Trophy winner Terry Baker broke free for a 99-yard touchdown run to lead the Beavers over Villanova 6-0. Now known as the John Hancock Bowl, the Sun Bowl has had a long and proud tradition dating back to 1936. Played in El Paso, Texas, this classic has had its share of great games. Missouri ripped Auburn 34-17 behind big plays like this one.
35, Mosley. Mosley started at the 16, and can he be cut off? He cannot.
It was more of a Snow Bowl than Sun Bowl in 1987, as Oklahoma State edged West Virginia 35-33. Cowboy running back Thurman Thomas carried the ball 33 times in that game and scored 4 touchdowns. One of the most exciting Bluebonnet Bowl games was played in 1968 in the Houston Astrodome. Oklahoma and coach Chuck Fairbanks was a heavy favorite to defeat Hayden Fry's SMU Mustangs. It was a wild game, which saw SMU fight back from a 14-6 deficit to take a 28-21 lead with little time left on the clock. Oklahoma scored to cut the lead to 1, then decided to go for the 2-point conversion and the win. The Sooners' attempt failed as the Mustangs held on for a dramatic 28-27 victory. The 1980 SeaWorld Holiday Bowl featured one of the most incredible finishes in bowl history.
Zone 46, throwing for the end zone. Receivers are there, defenders are there. It is in the end zone. Who has the ball?
Now that we've replayed some great moments in college bowl history, here's a list of other classics that have provided their share of thrills over the years.
Well, now that we've spent the past hour paying tribute to all the great moments in college bowl history, we thought we'd take just a minute to reveal a list of bowls that never quite caught on. I mean, whatever happened to the Alamo Bowl? Got overrun. The Aviation Bowl? A bomb. The Dixie Bowl? Went south. The Los Angeles Christmas Festival Bowl? Shouldn't have been a bowl just because of its name. The Oil Bowl? Never got to the top. The Rumba Bowl? Nice beat, couldn't dance to it. And my all-time favorite? The Salad Bowl. Just another garden variety failure, I guess. Well, that's all the time we have for today, but we would like to take a minute to thank all the people across the country associated with college bowls for making this time of year one of the most exciting in all the sports. For great moments in college bowl history, I'm Barry Tompkins. Thanks for watching, and have a nice holiday season.